All right, welcome to the AVNI Interviews. We're your hosts, Eric Bork and Mikey Taylor.
What up?
We're the co-founders of AVNI, a brand for entrepreneurs and influencers and people doing their own thing. Here on the AVNI Interviews, we interview people doing the work they want and the lifestyle they love to help other people do the same thing. Today's episode is called Find Your Thing. So the way we're going to do this is towards the end of the episode, we're going to have seven specific things we've talked about and outlined for people who are looking to do their own thing that you can specifically do. And we're going to talk about Mikey's story because he's gone through this transition of being a pro skateboarder, losing all of his money as a pro skateboarder, and now starting a capital company, which I always say as a pro skateboarder, I felt like he was like a six or a five. And as doing what he's doing now, I feel like it's 100%. I feel like it's 100% him. And so I've been here through this process. So I'm going to ask him about finding his thing. I'm going to talk a little bit about finding my thing. And then at the end, we're going to go over seven specific things that we've outlined that you can specifically do if you're looking to find your own thing. This episode isn't going to resonate with everybody because some people have already found their own thing, but it will resonate with people who are looking for, what is my thing? What am I going to do? How do I get to do my own thing? So let's jump in. So Mikey was a professional skateboarder of 15 years, and he recently started, we've gone through this so many times, but he lost his main sponsor. And as a skateboarder, that's pretty much all your money. And while he was skateboarding, he started and sold St. Archer beer and got a good sum of money, but not enough to not work for the rest of his life. And when his skateboarding sponsorship ended, that was his primary income, he all of a sudden had to figure out what to do. And that process is what I'm going to interview Mikey about today. And there's some good insights there. And then I also have some insight on it. So, I'll also say this, we did an episode a few back called Quit Your Job, and it was the best reaction we've got. It was crazy. The amount of DMs and the amount of people that were just like, we got a crazy response from it, but it was also the next part of that, which is why we're doing this episode, was I want to quit my job. There was one step of, I don't know what to do, or I don't know how to do it. And then there was the next step of, I don't know what it is. And so that's why we're doing this episode today, is to figure out what it is that your thing is and how to get there. So we're going to start off. I'm going to just start off with like a crazy one.
Okay.
Before we interview you.
Great.
So I'm just going to say straight up, the biggest mistake that I made in figuring out, well, I guess I'll say this first. AVNI, I've always wanted to do basically learning and teaching and creating like superhumans, or creating people that are just thriving and doing what they're supposed to do. That's been my thing. It is my thing. It's what I want to do. It's always what I've wanted to do. And so for me, I'm in it. I can't, you know, get on this podcast and say I'm the most successful person in the world. But looking back, I'd say the time I felt the most like that was when I was a pro skateboarder for 1 year. It was amazing. It was like, I was like, I love what I'm doing. I'm happy every day. The hard times, they're hard, but the rest of it is so worth it. And so I kind of want to start off with a crazy one.
Go ahead.
Because the biggest mistake that I made is also the biggest mistake that I've made dating girls.
Okay.
I know it sounds crazy.
No,
but
I totally get it.
I was in, you know, a few relationships, and some of them are great people. Some of them sucked, but I basically was in a relationship for a long period of time, and then it ended, and I realized I shouldn't have been in that relationship for longer than a month or longer than 5 months. And I think finding your own thing in life is very similar. I think that there's people that spend, and personally me, I'll just say I spent long periods of time doing something that I knew wasn't what I wanted to be doing with my life, but I kept doing it because it was in front of me.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's easier to break away from, say, a relationship when you're a month in than when you're like, you know, years in, and then you have to rearrange your entire life. And so I kind of want to touch on today how to explore different things that you want to do and not get stuck in doing the wrong thing. And then if you are, how to get out of it. So that's kind of the intro. Now I want to interview Mikey about this process, and I'm going to tune it up with this. We've already talked about how I went to the bathroom and came out. You got the call from DC. You're just looking like, whoa, my whole life just is about to change.
Mm-hmm.
But let's kind of talk about during that time,
how hard it was for me to figure out what to do.
Yeah. And the thing that keeps coming to my mind is we were exploring all these different things. And for me, I was just like, AVNI, and it was called something else back then, but this is what it's always been. And Mikey was like, we were talking one night in his backyard, and I went to leave, and we were talking about doing AVNI. And I remember Mikey was like, you said something like, dude, is this what I should do? Should I do AVNI like full time? Should I just go all in? And keep in mind, you were going up your stairs. We had just hung out, and upstairs you had Jen and the two girls. So you're losing your career. Going, I have the weight of taking, and this is the one thing I heard from so many people in the DMs.
Yeah.
I want to pursue it, but I have to take care of my families.
Dude, totally.
Or my family.
Yeah.
And so I just remember as I was leaving that night, me and Mikey would just hang out. I think we hung out with Jen for a little. You were like, is this what I should do? And I remember sitting there going like, I don't think, and it was, I didn't want to say it at the time, but I was like, AVNI is part of you, but I don't think it's like your gift or what you were born to do in life. And I couldn't say it at that time, but now that you have commune, which I'm gonna kind of throw out there. Some people leave comments like, oh, Mikey, you're doing real estate. You're a realtor now. And it's like, I need to just kind of like throw this out there just so people understand how big of a deal it is what you're doing. You shouldn't be able to do what you're doing right now.
I should not be able to be doing what I'm doing
right now. You
shouldn't. No.
Mikey is the president of a legitimate capital company. So that this transition has gone from you not knowing what you're doing to, I mean, straight up, as one of your close friends, I'll say, this is your fit, dude.
Yeah.
Let me ask you, do you feel like this is your fit?
Yeah, I do.
Okay.
Yeah. The hardest part for me really during that time is not knowing. I hear a lot of people, well, what should I know? How will I know what I should do? What I never knew. That was always my struggle. And then coming from something like skating, where I loved it so much, I wanted that again, you know? And it was so hard for me to figure out what that was, what my purpose was for when it comes to what I should be doing with work, what the bigger kind of meaning behind it was. And I couldn't figure it out. It was so hard.
I see so many athletes specifically struggle with this because you have, and I'm going to throw this out there in the beginning. We're not going to spend too much time here talking about how to know when to be an athlete. In my opinion, if someone's good at something and they're an athlete, it's the dream life. It's almost like becoming an A-list celebrity. It doesn't even matter as much that you're A-list. If you love snowboarding, if you love skateboarding, if you love skiing, and you can make money doing it, I pretty much think most people are just going to do it.
Yeah.
Because it's a dream lifestyle. You get to travel, 100%. Everything's taken care of. You get to wake up whenever, it's a dream, right? So we're not going to spend too much time there because I think people kind of know when they're a fit. But we're going to spend time more talking about either what's after being an athlete or maybe the person that didn't make it as an athlete and they still want to do something that they love just as much. That's what I want to focus on today. And I want to make a very specific point based on what you just said. When you know, you know.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not a right fit, you're going to be confused and you're not going to feel good about it. That's the biggest thing.
Yeah.
If it's not a fit, you're not going to know that it's not a fit, but you're going to know that something doesn't feel right.
Yeah. You're totally right. But dude, that is so hard. Like when you're dealing with, and we did get a lot of comments about this. Like I have kids, I have a wife. When you're dealing with that much stress on your shoulders, responsibility for others, dude, it's like what I always told you. Don't make a decision with your back against the wall, right? when you have no job and two kids and a wife to provide for,
yeah,
your back's against the wall. You know what I'm saying? It's like, yeah. And it's really easy, I think, to make a decision and talk yourself into something being a good fit. I mean, dude, how many ideas did we talk about for me?
The craziest one for me is when you were talking about being an employee doing marketing at a company.
Yeah.
Like, and you had to explore everything. You had to explore it.
Totally.
And when you were saying that, I remember specifically, and dude, I know you felt it too. I remember going like, yeah, you know, I think you could do that. But I remember thinking, you're not going to be happy.
No.
You're not going to be happy. It's not going to be you. I don't care if you're an executive and you have this big VP title and everybody, you have, you know, 200 employees, like it's not you. And I knew it.
No, I know. I the thing is, like, I knew it too. I absolutely knew it. It's just, dude, I was in such a dark place.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Like I wasn't clear. I was frightened.
Yep.
You know? So it was like, I couldn't, I don't think I would have eventually pushed forward on it, but it was really Jen. She was like, are you kidding?
That's awesome to hear. I forgot.
Oh, yeah. Jen was like, you're not going to last a week. You're not built for that. You are not supposed to do this for other people. You're going to hate it. Look at your life to this point. Have you ever done anyone else's? Have you ever created someone else's dream? No.
Yep.
You've always done your dream. How are you going to go do that? What are you talking about? You know, and it was just like, I didn't have clarity. I was going through such a massive life change that was like, dude, it rocked me to the core, you know? And thankfully, like, I had you guys, helping me figure out what it was, but I always struggled with, what is it? Even with skating, I didn't set out to be a pro skateboarder. That was not my plan. I didn't have a plan. You know, it was like, it just happened.
And that's
the
part.
Which is scary, which is amazing, but is scary. You know, and then going into being a pro skateboarder and like having success at it, going, I didn't plan for this. Now I know what it is and I could succeed at doing it, but I didn't put together this grand vision.
Yeah.
And that's scary, trying to figure out what to do after skating.
So I want to speak to the people out there that are doing something that they don't feel is them. And the main thing I want to say is that the only thing you can't do is quit. It's not going to happen really quick.
Like quit your job to go do something else?
No, meaning just what happens is when you get into a position where you're like, I'm stuck, you start getting out of the, it's possible to do what I want. And I just want to reiterate, it absolutely is possible. You just can't get that thought out of your mind. So just keep going, keep looking at what it is. And then let's keep going on your story and let's talk about ways to kind of move yourself towards it. I have a few strategies here, but I want to go over a little more of your story first. Mm-hmm. Okay. So you considered being an employee.
Yeah. I considered it all. Well, look, the thing is like, there's more to that, right?
P-Rod's calling during the podcast.
P-Rod, dog.
Sorry, dude. We got to screen you, dude.
P-Rod, my bad, dog.
We'll hit you back.
There's more to that. The employee of a bit, it was Villager. I have a lot of money invested in a Villager.
Yeah.
So it was more, what was going on through my mind was, can I add value to help get this business to the point I need to help all of our investments, right? Yep. That's really what that thought process was behind it. But it wasn't like, dude, I wasn't just going to go like work for
it. No, it wouldn't have been a fit. And it probably would have been awful for your relationship with Josh.
Dude, honestly, if I would have done that, it would have, I think, ruined my relationship with Josh.
Yeah.
It would be such a bad structure for us because
for sure.
Josh is a leader. Mm-hmm. Josh likes calling the shot. I'm the same exact way. You can't put two people like
it
that.
It wouldn't work.
And it's like with St. Archer, it was beautiful because Josh was steering the ship. And I was still skating. Mm-hmm. So like I could be involved in like the bigger things, but Josh was running the show.
Yep.
Right? You can't go into where we're both, like if I was doing it with Josh, just us, dude, it would have been incredibly difficult.
And I remember there was a day and a half, and this is the part that I want to keep harping on this point because this is the one people are going to resonate with who are in this position. There was a day and a half where you sat in front of your computer and you started like checking emails like, trying to get yourself into, do you remember this?
Yeah, of course.
Being like, okay, I'm going to prepare myself to go. And it lasted a day and a half. And then you're like, nope, I'm going to do something else. Now, sometimes people aren't in the position to just be like, nope, I'm going to do something
and
else.
I will say, and we should say that, I was in a very fortunate situation.
Yeah.
I know that not everyone is in that position to where like I'm able to choose.
Yeah. We'll get into my story in a little bit about choosing when you have no choices.
Yeah.
But you also considered, what was the other one? There was another, oh yeah, online courses.
Yeah, yeah.
You, and Mikey is, we're co-founders in AVNI, but really, and Mikey's part of AVNI is beyond valuable. That's why we partnered up. But it's not Mikey's calling in life. It is in a certain way, but you have to have that thing that interests you. And for you, that's commune. Mm-hmm. It's commune capital. It's going out and buying buildings. And I didn't say that before, so I'm going to say it now. What Mikey's doing with real estate, it's really not real estate. He's going out, he's buying apartment buildings. They've already...
Well, it is real estate.
It is real estate.
The problem is most people don't know like all the different sectors of real estate.
Mikey is not going out and flipping homes. He's not going out and selling homes and taking a commission. He has a capital company.
Now you're making it sound bad for all the people that do that, dude.
No, I'm not.
Okay, okay.
That's it. It's not like we just interviewed Danny Morrell who does that.
Yeah.
And he makes makes tons of money.
Totally.
We know tons of people who do that. Tim Gavin, killing it.
Yeah,
making a ton of money.
Yeah.
It's just different.
Yeah.
So what Mikey's doing is he's going out and he's buying buildings of apartment units and then flipping them, renovating them.
Not flipping.
I know, I should not have said flip. Renovating them, and then basically you can charge more rent because they're nicer places to live. And over the long term, you make really good passive residual income. So that's... To be in the position to do that, Mikey had to have a few components. One component that you had, and the components is an important part because components of what you have available to you is an important part of what you choose to do. You had Randy, who you've known and who has done many projects in the past.
Mm.
And you also have a little bit of money from St. Archer that you can invest from St. Archer and Skateboarding that you can invest into buying buildings.
Mm-hmm.
Most people don't have enough money to go out and buy a building.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously part of it's a loan, but you have to have capital to start a capital company. So that's the only reason Mikey's able to do this. But I mean,
kind of, I know what you're saying, but I think the listener's not going to be able to, they're not going to know. So anyone can go out and syndicate apartment deals.
Right.
You don't need money to do that, right? You need to raise money to do it.
You need to raise money.
But you can do it, right? And I could do that. The difference is I'm not basically syndicating would be if I went and found a building, I got a pool of investors together. Mm-hmm. We all came in, bought the building, whatever we did with it. Right. What we did with Commune, it's a full fund structure.
Mm-hmm.
It's not one building. We have multiple buildings inside our fund that generate kind of a blended return for our investors. Right.
Right.
It's that structure of a fund. When I say I shouldn't even be like, it's crazy that I'm even able to do this. That part of it is I was blessed to have Randy and Jerry in a relationship with them and experience with them to partake in something like this, right?
Yeah.
That side of it, I couldn't, but there is a lot of similarity to syndicating apartments,
right?
That really you could go do, Tommy
right.
could go do,
right.
You know?
So
it's the fund structure.
We're going to have to get into that in another episode.
Yeah, yeah.
We're going to have to get into that. There's a lot of detail. But what I'm getting at is that you spent months just listening to podcasts and I remember kind of when it clicked, you were like, this is what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
And we were at, I think it probably clicked way before this, but there was always a part of you that at first you were like, this is what I have to do for my family.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember it was like, you mean you're just going to go, you're like, I have to. Yeah. And I was like, you're not going to post, you're not going to skate. And you're like, I don't know. But you were like, this is what I need to do where I'm at in life. And dude, knowing how much you love skateboarding and knowing how much, dude, you're Mikey days. You're out there in front of the world, like on camera for years. And so for you, just, and I'm pointing this out because that was a tough call.
Yeah.
Now it's come full circle and we're doing content and we're doing AVNI and we're doing a podcast and you're doing, you know, filming with Ryan. Like, but for there was a minute where you're like, I don't know, but this is the right decision and I'm going to do it. Yeah. And that's what I'm getting at here.
Yeah.
Is that there was a point when I watched you and I was like, holy shit, he's just going to give it up. And you did. You're like, I'm just going to give it all up.
Yeah.
Because, but the, here's the point. You knew it was like, I saw that when that happened, it clicked and it was like, boom, this is it. I'm doing this. I might not be on Instagram anymore. I might not be on YouTube. I might not be in videos. I might, disappear, but this is what I'm supposed to do and I'm going to do it. And you did that.
Yeah. Yeah. I will say, if I do have a strength, that is one of them that if I make my mind up, I have no problem changing. But that was by far the hardest thing for me. I mean, dude, it's
and like I watched you struggle with it. You like, I watched you go like, wait, I'm not going to have Mikey days. I'm not going to like be able to go to the skate park every day. Like,
oh yeah.
And I watched you do it and it was like kind of impressive or kind of like, wow, you really made this call.
Yeah.
But
this is the thing, right? I get a lot of comments about this on my Instagram. So I do want to talk about it. People go, well, you lost your sponsor. Like
I saw
like that means you lost your career. You're Mikey Taylor. Why did you just stop? Right.
Yeah.
And dude, I would have said the same thing when I was younger, because I looked up to all these pros and go, you could get sponsored by whoever you want. You cannot. Right. When I lost my sponsor, I lost all my income. Mm-hmm. If I would have had another sponsor come in and pay me to skateboard, I would have done it. I would have kept skating,
mm-hmm.
right? Because I really wanted to skate a few more years. That didn't exist. Dude, right now, deals are not there, right? You're watching, for the most part, everyone struggle.
And I'm not going to name names, but I'm 100% with you. There's the like dwindling career where you try to hang on for so long, and it's almost like the guy that gets dumped and then like keeps going back to the girl, even though she doesn't want
him.
It's like and I'm not naming any names specifically, but you don't want to like have a career where it's miserable. You don't want to go get on when you used to be skating for the best company, you don't want to go get on the worst company, make no money, and then go to the skate park and not make any money. Like it's not that fun of a, it's tough.
Yeah.
You know?
So this is kind of where I was at with it. Right. I looked at it and went, dude, I just had surgery, right? I hadn't even skated when I got kicked off. And I went, okay, I could spend the next 6 months basically rehabbing,
mm-hmm.
take another 6 months to feel like I'm skating good enough to, you know, really do something. That'd be a year out.
Yeah.
And then like I could try to get another sponsor for the next year. Now I'm 2 years out. Like what I didn't want to do is put my like selfish desire of wanting to still be titled as a pro skateboarder, right? Yeah. And put my family really through that because I wasn't willing to let go of my ego, right? Mm-hmm. And that's the reality of it. It's like, dude, do I love skating? Fuck. Of course, this wouldn't have been such a shocker if I didn't, right? It was just, I didn't want to be the dude who tried to continue to be seen inside of skateboarding for years beyond
Absolutely.
When I should have been, right?
Absolutely.
And I saw the calling and went, okay, this is probably my time, even though I don't want it to be. Even though everything in me does not want it to be right now, this is the best time to do it.
Yeah.
And then once I made that decision, then it just became, well, what the hell do I do?
Yep.
What am I going to do that I enjoy this much? What am I going to do that's going to give me this much satisfaction as skating did for the last 20 years, right? And then it just became a new struggle.
Yep.
But it's like, dude, it's like, look, I have a family. Like, I can't just put them out on the street because, like, I still want to be a pro. You know, I had no deals. There was no money coming
in. Yeah, and that's one thing that we will emphasize. Yeah, if you want a deal, like, board companies are not going to support you.
Well, no, it's just they're not.
There's a few people that they'll support them.
Let's do a breakdown because I know a lot of our listeners are skaters. You don't make anything from a skateboard company.
Right.
No one does. Ever.
And when we say anything, it's like maybe 1,000, 2,000.
2,000 is like seriously the peak of it, right? The majority of pro skateboarders sponsored by a board company might make between $500 and $800 a month.
Yep.
Right?
From their board company.
So a board company isn't enough to move the needle, right? Anything beyond that is going to be skateboards, a apparel, which is basic, I'm sorry, shoes, apparel, which is basically shoes now, or an energy drink sponsor, mm-hmm. right? And dude, how many more people can be sponsored by Nike? How many more people can be sponsored by Adidas? They're maxed out.
Yep.
So now you have the bulk of a skate industry not being able to make anything.
Yep.
Right? And it's like, dude, it's just it's what we're living in right now, man. It's yep. just, it's grim.
So there, you know? It is. And there's, everybody has
their, I don't know pain what point. My point was, no, but dude, it's the pain brutal
point.
Out there.
Everybody has their own pain point.
Yeah.
And we got a lot of DMs about, this is my pain point. That was your pain point, and it's a very real pain point that not a lot of people know about, is that there's a major shift in how things are sold, and it's like it's going direct to consumer, and so that is becoming a major change in how things were before. So that's your pain point. You had the pain, you had considered a couple of different things. You found your fit. Mm-hmm. Like you found your fit, and let's get into that a little bit more. I it's my personal belief, not to get too philosophical, but I believe that everybody has something that they are good at. Mm-hmm. This is one of the strongest beliefs. I was a pro skateboard. I was traveling and I bought Deepak Chopra's book and he talked about Dharma. It's know and act as your true spiritual self, develop your unique gifts and use those gifts to serve other people. I've lived my life by that. And that's what I want to get into now, is that I really believe that everybody has something that they can thrive at, and that finding that thing is literally going to be one of the things along with family that makes your life what it is. And like I said, I don't think I'm the most successful person in the world at this point, but I do think that I'm so happy that I'm in my fit. Mm-hmm. And you're in your fit. And so that's what we want to talk about now. So I'm going to talk about, I actually am going to share something from skateboarding. I was a pro skateboarder. Not everybody knows that. I actually forget it sometimes. But a long time ago, I was a pro skateboarder. And here's how I became a pro skateboarder. When I grew up, I was into girl skateboards. And then I started skating in Ventura. And Ventura is a little more hesh and rock. And I saw Jamie Thomas's part in Welcome to Hell. I became obsessed with that. Jamie Thomas was literally my living example of what I wanted to be. I would watch his, and I want to have Jamie on the show.
Me too.
Because I want to talk about this with him.
Yeah, me too.
But I would literally watch his video part. I must have watched his video part in Welcome to Hell 1,000 times, more than 1,000, probably 2,000 times. I would wake up and watch it. I'd go to bed and watch it. I grew my hair out like him. I did the same tricks he did. So when you're looking to find the thing that you want to do, modeling is a really good way to make it happen, because when you have someone who is actually doing, when you find that thing and then you see someone who's actually doing it, you then have a textbook. Mm-hmm. You can then go to that person and say, okay, what do they do? How do they do this? And you can model after the things that they do. So for anybody who's looking to find it, look at people and try to find specific people who are doing what you want to do or what you think you want to do. One of the times I remember is you had already decided you were doing a capital company, mm-hmm. but it was right when Grant Cardone started making this push. And I remember we were at Sun Life and we saw it, and it was like, almost like the pain that you had given up of like, I'm not going to be out there. He was putting it out there and you were like, I think, and tell me if I'm right here. You were like, I can still be out there and do this. And then you kind of started reintroducing your personal branding.
That's such a good point. Yeah. So
we had, just so you know, me and Mikey haven't talked about this. This on camera right now is the first time we're talking about this. You gave all that up. It was like a light bulb. Like, I can still do it.
Part of me thought that like I was going to be done with social media. I know. Done with my Instagram. I was at the point, I was like, what the hell am I going to post? I'm not skating.
Yeah.
Right. And then even when I like was like, you know what? I want to do this real estate company. And I want to like kind of how it all came to be. I was like, I'm going to do this and this is how I'm going to do it. But I couldn't figure out how to incorporate social media. I was like, what, wait, I'm a skater. How am I going to use my skate Instagram to like turn into real estate? Like that's exactly what happened. I saw Grant Cardone and he posted some video about him talking about real estate. And it clicked to me that like, holy shit, maybe I can still use my social media for something like this. That led to so many more conversations and trials and errors of like, now how do you turn a ship?
Yeah.
You know, 95% for sure. skaters into what I'm doing now that I couldn't figure out how it really related to skating, right? That became my new struggle, but that's totally true. When I saw Grant marketing it, that was like, holy crap, maybe I can still use my channels for this.
And we're going to do an episode on this, but because this is a super critical point. At that time, all of the dudes, and this is a little bit of hate, all of the dudes that were doing it, a lot of them seemed fake. And we were thinking about doing AVNI and we kept like going to jump in. And then we'd be like, oh, these guys are so bad. Like they're so like, they're like posting photos with jets and you know they don't own a jet. You know they don't even own like anything, but they're like next to a jet. Like, and we were just like, that is not us. And so that was kind of the turning point when it went away from those like fake dudes to like people that were actually real. Like that's when Gary Vee kind of started really like having an impact.
Yeah. And I think like going off your last point of like Jamie Thomas, right? Like when we were kids, we'd look up and see like what the pros are doing.
And it's
right?
easy as an athlete.
Yeah, totally.
Because you
easy.
See someone kick the ball or do 100%. A trick.
And the hard part was like, we come from the skate industry, man. There's like, dude, they're like too real to like a fault. Right. Yeah. And then like to like have this like, oh, maybe we can market it and look and like looking into like the entrepreneurial and the real estate and the motivation, like all those people with Instagram, it was shocking with how lame it felt.
It was disheartening. Right? It was like, we can't.
We were like, what? That we're watching all these guys succeed. Same thing as we were kids, right? Yep. We watch Eric Costin and Reynolds. We see the blueprint on how to succeed.
Yep.
And then we go to this. We're like, this is the blueprint? We can't do this.
And that's why it's taken us so long to
roll out. But it's funny. I remember you were like, we can't do this. And I'm like, I know we can't do this. Like, we cannot do it. And then it was like, we came to the realization, we're like, you know what? We just need to do us. Even if no one is doing it the way we're doing it, we have to do us.
And at first there was no one really, you're seeing more and more people that are like coming out and actually being authentic and real. And you're like, oh, okay. They're not like taking the photo next to the Rolls Royce. That's why like last week when Paul brought over the Rolls Royce, I posted it and I was like, I drive a Prius. Like, it's weird being in that car. You don't want to make eye contact with people.
No, it's
like such a different thing. And I mean, dude, that's Paul. That's like really him. Like he loves it.
Yeah, he loves it.
So good for him. But for me, it's not me. And the point I was getting at is that there was, again, that time when you were looking at what you were doing, you were like, I'm not going to go out and get on social media and look like this. You knew it wasn't a fit. And whenever that's the case, you know it's not right. So don't do it.
Yeah. And I will say this, like, you're totally right. There were so many things that I questioned doing or wanted to do, and just something didn't feel right. But I like felt so much pressure behind it that I was like kind of really trying to talk myself into it. And then once I found the thing, it felt so right. But what's always been hard for me is like, I was sitting there trying to think of all these things. What should it, online learning, employee, like all these things, dude. Coffee, I was thinking about everything. And like how Commune came to be was not me just sitting here going, I got it.
Mm-hmm.
Not it, right? Fluke phone call with a friend, with Sean. And that phone call led to the idea.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like, I never had the plan. So it's always been hard for me to like tell people, especially like the listeners, I can't tell you a blueprint on like how you figure it out because I've never known.
Yeah.
It was always like, I was in a position and like, I knew I had to figure it out and just something randomly like came to
me. So let's put some structure to that. So there is some structure to that. So I have a specific example. I wasn't planning on sharing this one. And then I have another one that I was planning on sharing. I remember when I was working in corporate America, my friend got hired at OGO and he moved his family out of state to work there. He got there. And then I remember within like 3 months, he was just like, this is not a fit. And I remember going, dude, you're crazy. But he was like, nope, it's not a fit. He's like, I'm moving. I'm like, what? I just got you this job. Like, and then within 2 months, he quit and moved and got another job. But that's the point I was going to share is the companies who are good at hiring, they have like a trial period and they fire fast. I take that back. The best ones screen really well before they hire. But even those ones, once it's not a fit, they figure it out as fast as possible, and then they get the right person in for the job. And that's the biggest thing I would recommend with this. It's not, it doesn't mean that you just quit and leave right then, but if it's not the right fit, don't go on for years. Start looking at your other options and transitioning into those other options. And that, not getting stuck. The biggest thing I think that got me stuck, and I'm going to talk a little personal now, is I think I've done 20 different, like when I say I've done, I mean, I went and got a job as a server. I went and got a job selling cars. I went and got a job at a startup. I started my own tech company. I started doing this. I think I have done probably at least 20 things. I should count it out one day. And the biggest, the most painful ones were the ones that were not a fit, where I was miserable and I just stuck it out. So if it's not a fit, start right now. You're not stuck. You have one life. Like, go. I know it sounds so cliche, but start moving towards something that's going in the right direction. So far I'd say that. And then I'd also say, start looking for models. Because when I became a pro skateboarder, it was because I was going to the skate park every single day and training to be just like Jamie Thomas. And I was training, and for you, it was probably Eric Costin, right? Mm-hmm. You train to be just like them. Find people. These are just, I want to give some practical mechanical things that people can use. Fire fast, or if it doesn't, I guess those are two separate things. If it doesn't feel right, it's not right. If it feels right, if it is right, it will feel right. So if you're in something right now that doesn't feel right, it's probably not right. And you probably need to start thinking about what is right. In addition to that, I would say, don't ever get stuck. You're never stuck. I felt stuck so many times, like I couldn't get out of a certain position, but really you can. You can get out. You just have to tell yourself you can, and then slowly start to do it. And then modeling. Find someone that's doing what you want to do. And when you find that person, at first you might not be able to think of who it is. Like, for example, for me right now, there's no one doing exactly what I want to do. There's a few people that I have a hybrid of. Like, there's, for me, it's Gary Vee and Joe Rogan are the two closest. But the funny thing is neither of them teach. And what I love is like the training and getting people going. So I'm still trying to find, I have a few, but who is that third component of who I, those are my models. Those are who I want to be like. The podcast, Gary Vee is like the lifestyle stuff for us. That's culture and skateboarding. So find models, find people that you can emulate, because then you have a blueprint and you can see what actions they take, how they did, like literally financially, how they did what they're doing. Because I mean, like for you, it just so happens that Grant Cardone also does multifamily. He buys buildings, and that's exactly what you're doing. So you now have someone that you can look, and also A-Rod. You have people that are doing what you're doing that you can emulate and model. Now, obviously, you're going to put your own twist on it and you're going to do it a little bit different. But having people you can model is a great, great way. And that also helps you know, and this is a part that's really hard, and I want to touch on this right now. I'm a dreamer, and I want to do a lot of stuff that does not exist. And I think that's one of the things that has caused me a lot of pain, is that there's not a market for it. And I've said, I'm going to change the market. And you can do that. I don't want to say you cannot do that. I don't want to discourage anybody who legitimately feels like they can change the market. But if you're going to change the market, and we're talking about making money doing what you want, you still need to be able to make money doing it. And that's where I went wrong, is I said, it's funny because I literally said, I'm going to do what's going on right now with online learning, but it wasn't going on back then. And so I didn't make any money doing it because no one was doing it. And now it started to happen, and there's actually a market. There's credible people online that teach you very valuable things. So the next kind of mechanical, practical thing I would say is that when you find a model, that also tells you there's a market there. People are making money doing that. And then take a real look at it. So one thing I would say is I get hit with this a lot, and I don't want to ruin anyone's dreams right now, but I'm going to throw out another alternative. If someone came to you today and said, I want to start a skateboard company, what would you tell them?
Don't do it.
Why would you say that? Oh. And keeping in mind, Mikey has a skateboard company. And you love your skateboard company. And it's amazing. Why would you say, I would tell, like anybody that hits me with that, I really quickly tell them not to. And I'm going to tell you what I hit them with after this. But why would you not do it? It's the math.
It's the math and how far you can take it, right? I love skateboard. I love skateboarding. I love skateboards. I love everything about it. When you start getting into the business side, right? It's one of the only things that the consumer price has not changed on in 20 something years, and expenses and cost of goods has only gone up, right? So it's a model that is so broken, and the amount of people that you can actually sell it to are so small that like just your shot at it being anything stable is very slim.
Yep.
Right? It's tough, right? And even when you do it and you pull it and you kill it, it's still so small.
If you pull it and you kill it and you're like doing really good, it's still not, you're going to hit a ceiling.
Yeah.
You're going to hit a ceiling.
Yeah.
And then you're going to end up going like, you know, I wish I could have done something where I made more money than this.
Yeah.
Because you're going to hit a ceiling, and as much as you love it, you're not going to be able to grow past, as a skateboard only brand, what you really want to do. So what I do tell people is start a direct to consumer product brand. Mm-hmm. That right now is hot. You can create a product, or you can have it manufactured for you. And because you're skipping the retailer, you can still make decent margins.
You can make
Facebook ads.
You can make good margins.
And ship it from your house. You don't have to have a warehouse to start and start a company. A great way.
Dude, we do not have a warehouse with Sovereign still.
Yeah.
You do not need a warehouse now.
That's
you don't
a little
need people to operate a business now.
Yeah.
It's
so just to explain so that makes sense, there's a couple different ways you can do it. What Mikey's talking about is a 3PL. It's a third-party logistics company, and they handle all of your shipping for you. You can also do it and save a little bit of money depending on what you're shipping. You can also do it and ship it from your house. Like, I know people that have done that, and they'll just ship it. They'll start shipping out of their house.
Yeah, it depends on the, like, skateboards are big and heavy.
Skateboard, and that's the other thing with skateboarders. Skateboards,
yeah.
They're but heavy and expensive.
But dude, I do have friends who start, one guy's like a shoelace company. I have a ton of friends doing clothing brands. Dude, they put all the stuff in their garage or their room.
And so there's, let's say something practical. If you're looking at starting like a skateboard company, I would highly recommend, instead of doing that, start a direct-to-consumer product company. Create your product. There's two ways. There's more, but you either keep it at your house and ship it, or you have a third-party logistics company ship it for you. There's also companies that do all fulfillment. They'll manufacture it and ship it for you.
Yeah.
And we might get into that like in more detail another episode. But my point is that don't jump into a market where you're going to invest a ton of money. Another one that I hate, and I just talked my sister out of this, is a restaurant. Restaurants are so
don't do
painful.
Restaurants don't do them, don't invest into them, don't get out of those.
It's
just eat at them.
It's
the
just,
worst.
The only one and the one I love is Joy Cafe.
Yeah, I
love
Joy.
They have
too.
A whole thing that they're doing. Something like that maybe is unique, but restaurants are painful. Skateboard companies are painful.
Yeah.
Just get into something where
there's light at the end
there's
of the
light
tunnel.
At the end of the tunnel where you're gonna have you're gonna be able to take care of yourself and have freedom and have money to spend. So that would be kind of the next point that I would bring up there. Okay, so now let's talk a little bit more about your story and once you got to the point where you were like, okay, I see what I can do. What did you start implementing? Okay, so you figured out it was a capital company.
Mm-hmm.
You figured out, okay, I can do this on social media. How did you start like taking action? I want to get into that real quick.
the hardest part for me was figuring out what. Once I figured out what, that part is just easier for me. It's a way more comfortable.
Yep.
So really, when I figured out what it was, then it just became, okay, so how do I do this? How do I put it together? Who do I need to do this? And it was just kind of plug and play almost.
The point I'm getting at here is this. Once you figure out what it is, so the title.
And I will say this, and what I did do also, which I just didn't say, dude, I soaked up information, right?
Yes.
All day, every day became real estate. Books, podcasts. My whole world was, how do I know more about what I'm about to do?
Yep.
Right? And look, there's also the other end of it of you just learning and never executing. Don't do that. There's definitely a cutoff on, you're not going to experience anything else until you jump in.
Yep.
But that just became my thing. It was just, what do I need to know to be able to do this? And then it was, how do I do this? What size? Who do I need as my partners? How do I get cat? And then I just put it all together.
So my take home point here is, when you find the thing that's your fit, you will do anything. If you're interested in it and it holds your interest, you will do anything to make it happen. Now, that the flip side of that, and I have to say that before we move forward with that point, is if it's not your thing, I've done some things that were like 90% my fit, but when it came down to persevering and when it came down to sticking through it, like AVNI, I will die before it fails. And it is what I've always wanted to do. It's 100% me. It's my dream. And because of that, I'll do anything. But the things I did that were a 90% fit, that were like, oh yeah, it's good, but it wasn't it. And you won't persevere. You won't have the, when it comes time to stay up till 4 a.m, when it comes time to basically not know how you're going to pull it this month, that's the part to remember, is make sure that what you're doing feels right and is 100% you. And if you do that, the how will unfold and it will naturally happen. And I think the reason I'm making this point is that you've made the point a bunch of times that you're not sure, or you didn't know. And I guess what I'm getting at is, when you're not sure, it's usually not right. That's usually how it's gone for me. It's like, I'll try to force, that's a way to say it. When I'm trying to force it, it's usually not right. Okay, so now let's jump into, we've prepared a list of 7 specific things that you can do to help find your own thing. So the first one I'm gonna go over again, I went over last episode, but I'm gonna do it again because I didn't go through it right last time. It's blue sky thinking. Blue sky thinking, or imagine if you had all the money in the world. And this one is something I learned from reading Tony Robbins, Jack Canfield, and Brian Tracy. So imagine if you had all the money in the world, what would you do with it? Write it down. And as you start to do that, the first thing you're gonna do is you're gonna go, I would buy a car, I would buy a house, I would go on vacation. And you'd start to think, I would do this. And then as that starts to happen, you start to see yourself in a place where you can do anything you want. And that's when desire and passion and your fit starts to come out. Then you'll start to see that in a, if I was rich, this is what I would do. So if I had a giant warehouse and all the money, I would do this. What happens there, that's where I think the key part of this exercise takes place. Write a list of what you would do. For me, it would be, I would get this compound at this resort, right? Well, that's going to cost me way more money than I have right now. But as I start to write down what I would do at this resort, I can do 75% of those things right now. And so the value in this exercise comes from, once I've identified what the things I could do in my fantasy land are that I would want to do, check off the things you can start doing right now and start doing those things right now. And that's where the value of the exercise of thinking, what if I had all of the money in the world, comes from. Mm-hmm. So that's number one. Number two, don't get overwhelmed and get stuck. Break it down to a reasonable metric. That's one that I've been in the position where it seemed like it was impossible to break away. And so I stopped thinking about it. When you stop thinking about it, it stops becoming an option. And so be okay. Write down, this is what I'm getting at, write down a reasonable metric. So for me, for example, there was a point when I said, I need to learn how to build a website where I can charge people money. And I had to figure out how to do that. And so I knew that I had to do all these other things to make money, but I knew that that was a part of getting me to where I wanted to go. And so I made a reasonable metric. I'm going to, bless you.
Excuse me.
I'm going to take a WordPress site, website course, and then I'm going to learn. At the time, I got membership software. I do it a little differently now. And I'm going to learn how to do that. But if you stop, you're not going to progress. If you break it down to a reasonable metric, then you can do that day by day. And I mean, over the course of a year, I learned how to build a website. I learned how to charge people money. I learned how to make videos. I learned how to do that all over a year at a time when I was working another job. So don't stop and break it down to a daily or weekly metric. That's number two. All right, the third one, and I want Mikey to tune in here. This one, for me, is the most amazing part about the world we live in right now, is if you're looking for your thing, search and find podcasts to listen to. And it's important to find one that you click with. That's really important. Mikey, what are some podcasts that you clicked with in doing this? In figuring out what your thing?
The one that I actually clicked with me the most was apartment building investing.
Okay.
This sounds so weird.
I know.
Well, that's so the funny weird thing. That was the one that hit me.
But that's a side of you that people don't know. And that's a really good point.
Yeah.
Is because people don't know, like, when you start talking to you, like, a lot of times you'll respond like, that's not going to work. But they don't understand. And I've known you long enough to know you're breaking down numbers in your head. You're going, well, that's not going to work because this and the margin and that. And then you just, that's not going to work. Yeah. And a lot of times I'll be like, yes, it will. And you're like, no. And then we'll walk through the math and you're like, I'm like, oh, you're right. So people don't know, but when you started listening to that, you're like, I can do this.
Yeah, that was
a
good one.
Win.
Yeah,
I can kill it.
Yeah, that was a good one. Lifetime Cashflow Real Estate. The podcasts that I like the most are mostly real estate based.
And seriously though, I'm gonna stop and say, how many people know that about you? Not that many people know that. Like, yeah, and you just go in and you're like, oh, I can do this, and I can buy the building, and I can do this, and like, but the point is you found that and it clicked with you.
Yeah.
You were like, and I remember I'd get in your car at the time you just discovered them. You're like, I'm listening to this one.
Yeah, and I would sit there and be like,
yeah.
But it was like, dude, when I hit that one, there's always something that grabs you, right?
Yep.
With that one, it was all based around raising money for buildings, right?
Yep.
And also, like, at the time I learned that real estate, commercial real estate it's more operated like small business, not like what I thought my house worked like. So it was like that happened, and then like I could raise money for it, and then it brought me back to like, dude, when we raise money for St. Archer and like starting that, it was like, oh my gosh, I could start a business in real estate also. And that was like the investment vehicle I use. It was like this all coming together of like,
it might be my downfall, but it's not the most interesting thing to me. But to you,
no, that's how it is. Like, and when you talk to me all like all this like tech shit, I'm like, nah.
And well, that's the next point I was going to make, is that the one that I clicked with the most was Mixergy.
Yeah.
Which was a tech podcast. And because I am absolutely obsessed with the concept of having digital products where I make residual income. It's been my, like, I'm obsessed. So when I heard that, I was like, let's go. Yeah. But to everybody listening, it doesn't have to be that you click with the real estate one. And it doesn't have to be that you click with Andrew Warner of Mixergy, who is like my favorite podcast. But what's that?
I thought you were going to drop mentor.
No, we'll get into that another time.
Okay.
But I mean, find one that there are so many programs out there. Go find it. A great one, Andy Frisella, MFC.
Yeah, his
CEO,
is great.
CEO.
Yeah, his
like,
is great.
If you want to get pumped, that might not be your style. Like, he's very aggressive, but his is really, really good. And he does a lot of episodes where he just sits there and he just goes at it, which there's a lot of people that love that. Okay, next, we've already covered number four, is model, find the people. Write a list of all the people that you admire and pick the ones that you want to be like. And if you can take their course or whatever, do it. If not, study them. You can Google them. You can learn. Pick the top ones. A lot of people will have pictures on their wall of them, but modeling is such a powerful tool. When you find someone you want to be like, that's all we did in skating.
Yeah, that's true.
As kids, I definitely attribute that to me progressing and being a good skateboarder.
You know what's funny? You brought up Jamie Thomas.
Yeah.
I think Jamie Thomas was probably the most influential skateboarder on my life and kind of what I ended up doing.
Yeah.
For real. Like he was the first one that I saw filming somebody. I was like, well, you're a pro skateboarder and you film. And then I found out he had a company and it was like, I wanted to have all that because of him.
And he's an entrepreneur. He owns a company. Like there's so much about him and his story is amazing. Him being homeless, sleeping in his car. Yeah. Like there's so much about him that is just, and literally I am not kidding. I brainwashed myself. I watched his video every day. And then it was easy. When I went outside, I had the Dickies. I had the long hair and I jumped down the big handrails. It's what I did because I had a model of exactly what I wanted to do. So modeling. Okay. Number five, and this is an important one. Find something that you can tolerate to do for work that gives you enough freedom to keep looking for what you're looking for. And it's funny because looking back on all the things I did, I drove Uber and I hated it. People would be in my car, like being disrespectful, and I would want to turn around and punch them. I wasn't the worst Uber driver ever. I had to stop because I hated it so much because people are rude. And my pet peeve is people being rude. So don't do something. And then there's Kevin who does it and loves it. And there's a few people we know who do it and love it. But find something you can tolerate that gives you enough flexibility. And I will say, if anybody out there is doing the 9-to-5 thing, some 9-to-5s are a blessing. They're amazing. You get the corporate card. You go on trips. You can turn your brain off at 5:00. Other ones, you go 100 hours a week. You're drained emotionally. You're physically out of shape. It's intolerable. So if that's the case, try to get yourself into something where you have spare time that you can tolerate. Because if you're in that one, and I know a lot of people who are, and I did it too, and Olivia used to do it too. Basically, find one you can tolerate that gives you at least a few hours a day. That is a really important one. The next, number six, I'm going to say is back to like the date. This actually isn't a good dating analogy. Date a lot. Like you don't just pick the person you're going to marry. Most people don't. You date a lot. You find different things. Start a new job if it's not right. Stop it early, move on to the next new job. Find things that you like and dabble in different things. If you want to find the right person for you, you usually have to date a lot of different girls. Some are going to be good, some are going to be bad. You're going to learn from each one. But if you don't get out there and explore different things, then you won't know those different things. So I'm going to say the number six is try different things for short periods of time. Don't get stuck in things for long periods of time. And then number seven is, and this is the biggest one, I think that's the biggest opportunity right now, is online programs. So find online programs. We're probably going to do a whole episode on this, but a very important point is do not be turned off from all online programs because there are some fake guys selling online programs. Everybody's selling online programs, but it's almost like book covers, right? So some book covers you look, you go, oh, that's an amazing book. But really, it's just someone trying to sell a book and there's no substance to the book. So open the book up, look at the back, look at the person, but find an online program that, I mean, you can literally get a new career. Oh, this is a good one. Someone DM'd me the other day and they're going to school for social media marketing. It's $8,000 for 2 years. They're going to school for social media marketing. We're going to be offering a course for social media marketing. It's going to be way less than that, but they're going to a full university for social media marketing.
I wonder how effective that is.
That's what I was, that I kept asking him, like,
I would never
so what
do
you learn? And he's like, I'm just starting. And I'm like, the one thing he did say is he's like, they don't tell you how to get clients, which is the absolute, that's like the biggest part of the course that I'm going to show.
Yeah. But what I can't figure out, this is the crazy thing about school to me, right? You have mm-hmm. a whole curriculum. Dude, social media changes every day.
For sure.
So how, dude, how is the course changing every day?
The one, there's a few things I could see is that, and this is going to be a part of our course, is you need to know how to create content. Whatever the medium is, you need to know how to create content.
That's very true.
And not only, but the other funny part is that the next thing you need to know is how to get clients. Yeah. That's the most important part.
Yeah,
and that's the part that almost like ruined me is I didn't know how to get the right clients. And so I would get the wrong
clients.
You can
create all the content you want. It's like, I make you money.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally.
And then also what value, there's a lot of things you, social media marketing, that's one, but I don't want to, number seven, I don't want to only focus on one. I want to say, ignore the ones that are bad. Ignore the ones that are fake. Don't let that turn you off. Go and find the ones that are good. And there's more and more coming out all the time. And there's some really life-changing good online programs. Like I said, I always say this, we will be offering more programs in the future, or programs. We're launching our first one in the near future, but don't be turned off by people who are fake. Find the good ones. Open the cover might look great. Open the book up. See what they're all about. Look at their social media. You can tell when someone's fake.
Yeah.
You can tell. You can look at the picture with the jet. What's your net worth got to be to have a jet? No. To charter a jet. What is it, like 10 grand? What is it to charter a jet?
No, it's more than that.
Dude, just for one trip?
Dude, when we went to Warren's, we went from LA to Colorado.
Yeah.
40K or something
Yeah.
like that?
Yeah, okay, so it's like 40. So if someone's posting photos by jets.
But that's different. That was his own jet. I think he could do like the
it
whole
was,
like,
for, he was real. That, he was real. Like, you know he's real.
Yeah, yeah.
So look at their social media. If they're posting a bunch
of pretty
fake
much,
shit,
dude, if they're bragging about everything they have and have done, they're probably fake.
They're probably right? fake. And even if they have, like a lot of times, even if they actually do own like a Rolls Royce, it doesn't mean they have money. It doesn't mean they know what they're talking about. Find out if the person knows what they're talking about.
Yeah.
Research it before you pay for their program. And I think in this day and age, people appreciate a lot more saying, I'm a small business owner.
Totally.
And just being straight up about it, as opposed to like, I'm going to teach you how to make $1 million. Like putting out, that's the one that drives me crazy. The $1 million this from someone who's not a millionaire. It's like, stop.
Yeah.
Stop it. So find the programs that are a good fit and research the programs before you buy them. Make sure you like, this is an important one. Make sure you click with the person. Make sure you like, you don't always have to, but make sure that they're providing the value that you need and don't be turned off by all of the fake ones. Okay, so those are the seven things that we had. DM us, let us know your feedback. We got some really good feedback. I think we're gonna do an episode on raising money. I think we're gonna do an episode on business partners.
Okay.
Like these are the ones that me and Mikey have talked about. DM us if there's any other ones. And you know what? If anybody has feedback on how to find your fit, that's kind of what our whole podcast is about. That's what our guests are all about, is how they found their thing and doing the work they want. We're also getting more specific to creating specific revenue streams. That's what our courses are going to be. They're going to be very specific things that you can learn from and go and put into action. So there's a couple other things I would say that I thought of on top of those seven. I'll just say real quick. Think about what you really like doing, what you don't have to try. For me, one of the things I really like if someone like relies on me, I really like that. So like people have been hitting me up since the one quit your job. They're like, hey, how do I, dude, I've DM'd people for like 3 hours. Like last night I DM'd this guy for 3 hours. I like doing that though. It like motivates me. So think about what you like doing, and that's not going to feel like hard or like hard work, and try to incorporate that into what you do. That's another one I thought of. And then another one, this is one I always harp on, is scan the market. Scan the market. Yeah. And those models you're looking for, the reason is because they're proving that you actually can make money doing it. And find where the market is at, where people are actually paying for something already. And then take your dream and incorporate your dream into that once you found a solid way to make money. And the last one I thought of on top of the seven is ask other people around you. Ask your mom, ask your dad, ask your best friends, ask your, and like you said, for you it was Jen.
Mm-hmm.
Jen was a big one. She's like, and it's funny because I wanted to say that to you and I didn't. And then Jen jumped in and was like, nope. And I was like, thanks, Jen. So anyways, hit us up with any other topics you want us to cover. Hope this one was valuable. And we can never say as much as we want to say in these. So if there's anybody out there that has like a specific question, DM us. We've responded to all of them. Sometimes we'll respond and then like won't be able to for a couple of days, but we always get back. So hit us up. And then also any other episodes that you want us to cover. Like I said, a business partner one, raising money. That's one we get hit up a lot about. Mm-hmm. And that's something that Mikey knows a lot about. Then maybe we might do one like specifically on, I don't know, your capital company at some point.
All right.
And then we should do one on finances with Randy too.
Okay.
All right. So that's a wrap for this one. Don't forget to subscribe. You can listen on iTunes. Don't forget to leave us reviews on iTunes. We appreciate it. And we will catch you next time. Thanks, guys.